Hi everybody, today I will show you something, some basic concepts and some key concepts about React and about how to build user interfaces using React and then with Redux. So let's start talking about React. React was created by Jordan Wolf, who is a Facebook software engineer. Who used it for the first time on Facebook's newsfeed, and then it has been widely spread to all the user interfaces in different and various applications. The current version is the 16.13.1, released on March 2020. And if you want, you can visit the React website, in which you can find documentation, blog, tutorials, and also a lot of examples to better understand how to build your application using React and why to use React. So let's start with some concept about what is React. React is a JavaScript library that has been created for building user interfaces. And its biggest advantage is that it lets you compose complex UI using small usable elements called components. So you can imagine that, for example, if you have a web application in which you have to build an element that you have to reuse in different pages, for example, as a form or a button or a table, for example, you can create a component that describes the structure of this element with the rendering properties, so how the element has to be rendered, and you can custom the element itself basing on the page where it is rendered. So in fact, React allows you to handle dynamic contents for web application, and it is ideal to develop single page application that simulates multi pages. So this is because React allow us to dynamically change the content of a page, a web page, so we can create the most of the React application are single page, but they always simulate a multi-page where changing URL is just a process of mounting and unmounting of components. Some of React pros are that each element of a UI can be a component, so you can write each element of your UI as a component and develop a different behavior for each one of them. Then, as we said before, each component is a piece of usable code because you can create your custom component that takes custom inputs, and then you can reuse the same code in different places of the same application to render different contents and different data, for example. Then a component may contain children components. In fact, we will see that a React application has a tree structure in which we have a root element and then the children of each element. In fact, we will see some concepts and some basics about the DOM and the virtual DOM with React. And at the end, it makes easier building single pages applications that simulate multi-paging. We said that before. So what are React components? We say that React applications are based on components. And we will see that with React, it's possible to build two different kinds of components. We have the functional components, or also called stateless, and class-based components. This is why, and the class-based components that are called stateful. This is why in the first versions of React, the class-based components were the only that allow you to build components that have had an internal state. So you can imagine an internal state of a component as the internal properties of the component itself. For example, if we have a model, a card, or a table that represents data, we can imagine state as the data, for example, get from an API from an endpoint. And then we have the functional components that are only that are called also stateless, because in the first versions of React they were built to present only contents without managing the state. But since React 16.8, React team introduced some functions called React Hooks that allow to manage the component state also in the functional component. So in the actual version, in the React, in this version, the last, last version, is it's possible to manage the state with the functional components. And React is trying to let the users develop more functional components because they are developing more updates on them. Let's see how to write a React component. To write a React component, you have to use the JSX code that is a language created from React that allows you to write components in a HTML-like syntax, but note that it's not real HTML because JSX code is just provides syntactic sugar for a function of React that then will real append an element to DOM. So when you write JSX code that is like HTML, you are actually calling a React function that is react.createElement that takes three arguments, in which the first one describes the component tag, the second one describes the props of the components, and then we have the optional children for the component. So we have this function that can be also used instead of the JSX code. In fact, we can write React applications using JSX, that is like HTML, or just using react.createElement function. Let's see an example below. In fact, there is an example of a class component, as you can see, is just a JavaScript function that extends the component imported from React. And it's important to note that to be a component, a class must always extend the component from React, and it's necessary to have a render function, to call a render function that return an object. This object will have JSX code or, and also JavaScript code, with the constraint that the JavaScript code has have to be before the return statement. And in the return statement, you will describe the HTML-like syntax code, so JSX code, that has have to be just one root element, always one root element. So if you have to create a component with some components that are brother, we can say brother, you can add, you have to add a root tag. For example, you can use the fragment tag that is just an empty one. Then you can see in this example that in the return statement, we are creating a component using the div tag that seems to be the div HTML tag, giving it a props called class name with the value app. And it contains a child, yes, that is an H1 tag with the string hello. When we run our application, when we build our application, this code will be compiled into the call to the React create element function that, in this case, have as arguments the div as the first element in the tree, the props of the first element that are just class name with the value app. And then when a component has one or more children, and we have to call the function react.createElement in a nested way, because we have to create a tree of components of elements. So we call the react.createElement function inside of the first call for the first component with the tag h1 with no props and the string hello as child. Let's see an example of what is a component. This is a screenshot from the on page of React, the official website of React, and we can see that there's a pattern of elements in this page, because we see that there is a repetition of some pictures with a description on the left and a result element on the right. So we can probably imagine that these are the same components but different content, because we can imagine that in this website there in some part there is a component that render a content, a string content, an image, and a result tab. So probably there's just a component that takes the content as props, so as inputs, and then we'll them in the same way but with different image and text. Let's see more details about the class-based component and functional one. As we said before, a class-based component is just a JavaScript class that extends a React component and has a render function that inside of it will return a React element, so JSX code. In this case, I added something more than before, because we have also a constructor that calls inside of it super props. This is just for the inheritance of from the parent component that we call the constructor also of the parent component. And the constructor method is necessary when we want to initialize a state in a component. To initialize the state, we just refer the class with the this keyword, and we assign to the this.state property a new object containing the key and values we want. We have to be careful with this, because this is the only time in which we access the state in writing using this.state. Because the constructor is the only statement, the only function that can access the state in this way with to write it. And then we will use, as in the component did mount function, then we will see what is it. It calls not this.state.color, but this.setState with an object as argument, because we will see that we always have to assign a new object to the state. So we are calling the setState method, passing it the new object that will overwrite the old state. So if we write a div with an h1 with the string this is the this.props.name component, this will print this is the, in this case, as we can see below, is called as my component with the prop name first React. So this will print this is the first React component. But in the paragraph below, when I wrote my state color is this.state.color, this will print my state color is green and not red, because we overwrote the state. We will see some slides after this. The life cycle of components is described by some methods like component mount. But now let's see something about functional components. And I wrote the same code of the class-based one, because these components returns the same components of the before, the first one. But we can see that it has a different syntax before, because it's just a function, a JavaScript function, that takes some arguments, the props. And then in the return statement, it just call the props.name property without using this, because this is not a class. And then we see that also, even if this is a functional component, we are using the state. So we have the my state color is color. We are using here the use state function, that is one of the most used also of the React Hook functions that we said before have been introduced to let the functional components manage the state as the class-based ones. So I briefly explain what use state function does. But later we'll see some others React hooks. In this case, use state is a function that takes an input, an argument that is the initial state for that state part. In this case, we are defining a color in the state of this component, and this function returns two variables. These variables are used as, can be used to read and to change the state. So we can use the first variable to read the state, as in the paragraph below with the my state color is just color. The curly brackets are to introduce JavaScript code inside the JSX code. So we are referring to the JavaScript variable color. And then we could use the set color variable to change and to overwrite the old state, the old color state. But note that when you write a class-based component or a functional one, when you want to use it in your application, you will write the same syntax. As you can see in the last row, we use my component with the name and the value of the prop name, and the same is for the functional component. So the only change is about the development of the component, but we can use them at the same way. Let's see
I know that you can use in a functional component many use state codes for the same component using different keys.
Yes, of course. Okay.
So you can call, you know, set colors, set names.
Yeah, because
access thread.
You can build a complex state for a single component containing different keys and different values.
This stuff can be done also in the other type of component.
Yes, because when you initialize a new state in the constructor function, you can build an object with all the keys you want.
Whenever you call the set state, you can simply pass a subset of all the keys.
Yes, we will see them later, because this is an important aspect of programming in React, because we will see in the topic of the state immutability that when you assign a state to a component, you will also have to rewrite the old one. And if you want to change just a subset of the old state, you have to copy the old state and then overwrite the fields, the key you want to change. But we will see later.
You said that the beginning was staging components like the previous one. Then they added the functional components
stateless. Yes.
And then they added stateful functional.
Yes, because
so now we have old style components,
yes,
and new functional stateful
components. Yes.
Why should they choose the functional versus the...
I always advise to choose the functional ones, because in the last period React is working more on them, and the updates on the class-based components are stopped as the last update. So since when they introduced the possibility to manage the state on the functional components, they are trying to migrate all the applications in functional ones, because it's more simple, it's easier to write, easier to understand, and as you can see with the less rows of code, you can write the same thing.
Yeah, I agree that it's easier to write, but I don't agree that it's easier to understand, because here, I mean, it's not a remark for you, it's a remark for the graph. Because here I understand the constructor phase, the lifecycle phase, and the rendering phase. In the other slide, I see two constants.
It's just to.
And I have to assume that constants are created before I created the I executed the in these functions. It's not clear. I mean, if I move the costs under,
it won't work.
It won't work.
Yes.
Okay. So there are assumptions.
Yes, you have to just to know the specific, and then it will be natural to use them, because they introduced one specific React hooks for each behavior of the class one, the class based.
Yeah, I agree, but the definition of natural that you are saying,
in my opinion.
We see a lot of code like this, and we copy and modify for our purposes, but for the understanding why it works like this.
Maybe this is
I prefer,
okay.
My feeling is that they are moving toward that direction, because you have to have less.
Yeah, it's true. But some experience. But when you have something that doesn't work here, you have
it's easy.
You have to find where the stuff breaks in the other direction.
But I read a lot of articles in which developers advice to continue to keep using the class components to build the components with state, and they prefer the functional ones. But I think that in the next years React will only update the functional ones, because they presented them with the, as more easy, yeah, easier and clearer. Yes, but I agree that class components can be also useful.
Yeah, then of course the reason why they're moving on the other side is because you don't have to use the this keyword.
Yes.
And just with the this keyword, it's a mess. But
yes.
So they decided to add to that to the thing. Okay.
So.
Class components get explicitly bind these in lifecycle methods.
Yeah, it depends on the type of function that you use. Because if you use Argo functions that are an ECMAScript addition, then this is automatically binded to what you mean. If you don't use that kind of function, you have to declare what this is. I understand why they are not the function, but they are arguing this kind of identity. Okay.
So let's see something more about props and state, just some basic details to better understand what is the differences, what are the differences between props and state. So as you probably understood, props are just variables that are passed as an input to a component from the parent component. And these tell us that props are immutable for the component that receives them. Instead of the state that is initialized inside the component itself, so the component has is the only one that can update the state. We can change it and handle. So when we write, for example, my component name ZCL component, we are telling just this is the prop for the property name, but you won't be able to change it. You can just use to render it to read and not to change it. With the state, it's possible inside the component to manage and update it. Okay. Let's see just diagram about what is a stateless component and a stateful component, but I think you can imagine it. So a stateless component is just a component that takes props in input and then just render UI without doing anything else. It just takes props and renders some contents based on the props it received. A stateful component instead receives props, and then after it initialized the initial state, it updates the states every time, probably depends on the code, but it will probably update the state basing on the props, but you have don't do this common error, that is to copy the props on the state when you receive props from the parent component. Because if you do this in the constructor function, if you copy so the props, for example, the color in the state is the props.color, you won't receive on the state the update on props. So use props just as props, and the state initialized and managed by the component itself, but don't copy the props in the state. So now let's see something about the components life cycle. As we said before, we have some functions. There are more than these, but we will see just the most used and the most useful for basic application for our ZGL. And we can split a component life cycle into three main moments, three main phases, which are creation, update, and the unmounting, so the destroying, the destruction of the other component. When a component, and here we are referring for on class-based components only, when a class-based component is created, we saw that the constructor function is called to initialize the state of that that component. Then we have the render function that is required with the JSX code in the return statement, and only after the components has been rendered, the component did mount will be called. So the component will did mount is a function that is called only when the component has been mounted, and it can be useful for us to, for example, to write some asynchronous function. For example, if we want to fetch some data from an API when the components finish to render itself to be rendered. Then we have the update phase, in which we enter in the update phase when the props of the state of a component change. So the only way to update a component and to let it to be re-rendered is to change one of its props or one property from the state. In fact, we can handle the state of props changes using the second component React Hooks, that it's different from React Hooks function for functional components. And the component with the update function takes two arguments, which are the previous props and the previous state. This is important because when you use the component with update function, we always should check if the property of the state key we are monitoring has been changed. Because if we don't write a conditional code into the component update function, the component will update and it will be re-rendered at every change in the props of state. So we have to check the differences between the current props and the previous props, and from the current state and the previous state. And at the end, we have the unmounting phase, that is describes the phase in which a component is unmounted from the tree that describes our application. And this function can be used to call code that clean up the code we set up at the beginning. For example, if in the component mount we create a timer or with the function set interval, we save the timer ID inside the component, and then we will clear the timer inside the unmounting method to clean up the memory that was allocated for this component. Now we will see how to, when we have a React application, we can convert a class component to a functional one, because they are equivalent with the latest version of React. In fact, there is a React hook that can be used to substitute a class components lifecycle method. Let's see that. we say that a class component, when it's created, initializes its state, then it calls the constructor and probably the set state to overwrite the state when in the component did mount function after some operations. To do that in a functional component, we just use the useState React tools, as we saw before, that returns the two variables to read and to write that part of the state. Then we have the component will mount, that is another class-based components like cycle loops, that just takes functions, takes code that will be executed when React understands that the component has to be mounted. So before to call the constructor and the render method. This can be realized in the functional components just writing code before JSX, so before the return statement, for example, initializing variables or writing the function, it's also function, yes. Then we have the component did mount method for the class-based components that we saw that it defines functions that are called when the component have been mounted. And we can substitute this behavior in the functional components using the React use effect hooks. We can already note that the last one, component with unmount that we saw before, it's the same as the component did mount and the component did update for the functional one. So we see that for the component did mount, component did update, and component will unmount that tells when a component is being to be unmounted, are converted into the same function call, so React use effect with some differences. So the React use effect function is a React hook, so a function that takes a function that will be called in different moments, depending on the second argument that is called a dependency list. When we pass an empty dependency list, as in the first case, we are telling React that we want to call this function only when the component did mount, so only at the first render. If we pass a dependency list instead, so an array of variables, for example, we are telling React that we want to call that function only when at the first time, so also when component did mount, but also when one of the variables in the dependency list will change. So it can be used both for the component did mount and the component did update for the class-based components. For the component will unmount function, we see that we use the same use effect function as before with a difference, because we are writing here a function that returns another function, and the function returned is the function that will be called when the component will unmount. So as before, if we have to initialize a timer or an interval in our component, we can just save the interval ID in the use effect, so when the component will be mounted, and then write a return function, so return a new function in the use effect function to clear the interval ID that we set up at the beginning.
But the function that you pass to the use effect must be
a void function
with the signature. Special signature, or is a void?
It's
function?
A function that
takes nothing
and returns void, yes. With that signature. Let's see some theory about why you could use React for your web application. At first, it is an open source library, and it's one of the most used to build user interfaces, so you find a lot of documentations and tutorials, as we said before. For its simplicity, because the component-based approach is very easy to understand and to learn. For the user JavaScript, if you know JavaScript, you can just use it to write your components. And because React allows you to store the entire current state of your application in JavaScript variables. So it's more it's easier to write application in React, because we can just manage the state using variables, JavaScript variables, instead of DOM. Because working with the DOM is very hard. And creating an application with plain JavaScript without using React force you to use to change and update the DOM directly, but this can cause bugs, inefficient bugs, and unexpected behaviors in your application. So React solved this problem, introducing the virtual DOM. The virtual DOM. But first, let's see something about DOM. And the DOM, that is the document object model, that is simply a tree representing an HTML page composed by HTML elements that are nodes that can be modified using JavaScript adding or removing elements to change dynamically our page. So at the DOM, it's just a tree that contains all the elements in our web application. For example, in this image, we can see a document root element that has the HTML tag, and then the head, the body, and various elements as H1, an ordered list, title, etc. With React, we don't have to access to the DOM directly and to change it, because React does it for us, introducing the virtual DOM that is just a copy of the real DOM representing our application state. This has been introduced because with components that are responsible for listening to events and for the re-render of UI, we will have a lot of updates on the DOM, and it could be inefficient for big applications. In fact, we could want to only update the components that changed and not also the others, so the entire tree. This is done from React, because when you update your application and changing a component props or a component state, it compares the virtual DOM with the real DOM and just find the differences, and not re-render also not re-render the entire tree, but just the different nodes. This process is called reconciliation, and we can just see a description of this process here. So when the render function or return for functional components is called, the old virtual DOM is compared with the rendered virtual DOM, and then if there are any differences, there is the reconciliation process that will update the real DOM. If no changes, don't touch real DOM. So it's more efficient for big application, because won't update the DOM for every update on the components. Let's see some details about the reconciliation process and the diffing algorithm. So from React documentation, when you use React, at a single point in time, you can think of the render function as creating a tree of React elements. On the next state of props update, that render function would return a different tree of React elements. React then needs to figure out how to efficiently update the UI to match the most recent tree. So here, React introduces the diffing algorithms that is based on two assumptions. The first one is that two elements of different types will produce different trees. So if it finds an H1 and then a div, it will produce a new tree, destroying the old one. The developer can hint at which child elements may be stable across different renders with a key props. We will see an example in the next slides. So when React starts the diffing algorithm, it first compares the two root elements, visiting the elements to find differences. And if it finds that the root elements of the tree, the new and the old virtual DOM, have some differences, it will destroy the root node and all the components that are children of this one will be destroyed. So they will receive the component will unmount. Yes, the component will unmount method, and when it will be a new tree. It will build a new tree in which the new nodes will receive instead the component will mount and the component did mount functions. If the trees are of the same type, it just look at the attributes, the properties, and doesn't change the DOM node, but only the attributes that change. Let's see this example about the key props that we mentioned before. And in this example, we will see how it's important, the key attribute for a React element. In fact, if you don't write the key attribute in the children of a component, for example, in a list, also the browser will tell you that there's a warning because you should introduce the key attribute. This is because, let's see this example. For in the first column, we have an ordered list with two elements, one called first and one called second, but this is just the child of the component, the string that it will render. And then for some operation, imagine we added a new element, the third one, so we have the first, second, and third. When React will compare the two trees, it will find that the first and the second element are still the same, so it won't touch them and just will add the third one. Let's see the other example in the second column in which we have the list as before with the first and second element and then with some operation probably that changes that the order of the item of the list. And in this case, React just comparison basing on the position of the element. So it will find that the elements are all different from before, from the first tree, because the first one is now compared with the third element, the second with first, and then it will add a new element. So it's the most inefficient case. But if we add to each element of the list the key props, for example, just with the name of the child it has, so we have li key with first, li key second, when we add a new element, it doesn't matter about the position of the element because it will at first look to the key prop and it will find that there's still an element with the first key and the second key because you are assuming that the key will be always unique. Let's talk now about state immutability. So always from the React docs, they suggest you to never mutate this state, as we said before, because if you mutate, if you change and update the state, accessing it using this dot state, you probably will overwrite it when you're in some other part of the code. Probably you will call the set state method that will create a new object and then it will overwrite the mutation you made accessing the state. So the solution that React developed, so React is developed to treat the state as immutable, and it's useful also because in JavaScript there are a lot of methods that allow us to treat objects, arrays, and variables as immutable. So let's see some example of how to treat a state immutable. In this case, we are imagining to have a state that contains the user's key, that it's an array of string in this case, and we see the difference between doing this.state.users.push new user instead of this.setState with a new object that contains this dot state with the spread operator and users, that is another array. So what is the spread operator? The spread operator is represented by these three dots, and it tells to React keep all the old state object, and then modify just the key that I'm telling to you to modify. So we are telling in this syntax this set state, so set the state with a new object that contains all the old keys of the old state, but replace the key users in the copy of this old state with a new array that contains all the state.users, so the old array in the elements, and add a new element called new user. So we see that the spread operator can be used both for objects and for arrays in this case, that will keep the old object and array elements, but creating a new one. And we are not mutating, we're not updating the old state or the old array. Instead of the first case in which we called the push method that doesn't create a new array, but just modify it. Another example of mutability versus immutability are the method concat versus the method push. We saw the push method before, so this is the first example as before, in which we create a new object, but instead of creating a new array, we are mutating the old user's array in the previous state. This is wrong because the push method doesn't create a new array, but modify the old one. Instead, we can use the concat that concat the old array with a new one, but creating a new one. And this is important, we say, because if we then call in some other parts of the code the set state method, we would lose the mutations we made without creating a new object. Okay. Also, the use state React tools that we saw at the beginning with functional components grants you to create always a new variable. So it instantiates always a new memory region to don't mutate the old state, but always creates a new one, a new variable. It creates a new memory and a new variable in new memory. Just let's see here how to quickly start building your React application, because you can write it all by hand, but there are a lot of packages. This is Create React App that just allows you to set up your first React application. You just have to type, for example, npm install create React app to install it, and then create React app, my first app, to create your project. And then with the npm start command, you will start it on the localhost port 3000. Not that you could also, you would want to use npx instead of npm, because npx doesn't install permanently the package in your computer, but just install it, then creates the application in just one command, and then it will uninstall the package itself. Let's see now how a React project is structured. We have a common structure for all the React projects, and we have always the .log files that lock in the versions of the dependency you're using, so all the packages you are importing in your project. Then we have the package.json file that contains the project version and all the dependencies to download. In fact, when we can also deploy our project in another machine, another computer, and then just type the command npm install to download all the dependencies specified in the package.json file. Then we have the public folder that contains all the static HTML page. And in most cases in the React applications, you will see just one index of HTML file, because all the components, all the files are brought in JavaScript and not in HTML and CSS. It's all JavaScript code. And then finally, we have this sources folder that contains all your components, all your components JSX code. And it will contain also the index.js if you use JavaScript, or TSX if you use TypeScript, that get access to the root div from the index.html div file. And then it will contain also, yes, to also the components. Now, I will let you see some code about a simple application I wrote in the last day. I just started. This is a really simple application in which we have, as you can see, a list of meal categories. And you can imagine that each one of these categories is just a component, because you can see that it's the same pattern for each meal category, in which we have an image, the name of the category, and then an icon to with an alt. The application is very simple. We have so this list, and then we can choose to click in some of them to add them in a favorite list that can be visible in this panel. So when we click to the health icon, the food is added to the list of favorites. This is that's all. But let's see something on the code. So as we said before, we have in the public directory, we have the index.html file. This file has been generated by the React CreateApp package. The only thing I changed in this file is that I'm injecting my application in the HTML file. In the because in the body of this HTML, in the HTML file, we have the div with the ID root. And then in the index.tsx, this code is brought, has been brought in TypeScript. We are getting the element with ID root, and we are injecting our application in the HTML file. Then, so we write JavaScript code and we add it to the page, the React page. So let's see how this application has been developed. In the sources file directory, we have the components and containers. This is a division I made containers are the favorite panels. So the panel that contains all the list of favorites categories, and the product list that is the main page of the application. Let's start from the product list, or maybe from the app.tsx. Yes. This is the root element of my application. And we see the first thing we have to note that is that this code, this JavaScript J6 code, doesn't use anything. It doesn't call, it doesn't use the favorite list or the function that add products to the favorite list. But it has to define both the favorite list and the function, the variable to add a category into the favorite list, both the call, the use callback, or now we will talk about it, both the function that will add set favorites that creates a new object contains the old array with the new one. This is because in this case, we have to pass to the product list component and both to the favorites panel component this part of the state, because the product list has to render the list of products and then handle the onLike function. So when we click on the heart icon, and because it has to pass the same part of the state about favorites to the favorites panel that will render the list. Now the use callback, the use callback function is just another of the React hooks function that just lets you to create a function with a dependency list, in this case as the use effect, if you remember. And we're just telling to React, instantiate a new function, but don't instantiate new memory, don't use new memory until one variable from this dependency list will change. You cannot get, in this case, even if we don't use the use callback function, it will be the same, because the only way to update this component is that the favorite list will change. So every time the favorite list will be changed, it instantiates a new function, but it's just to let you see the use callback function. Then we see the product list component, that is the list of the new categories. And we see that we are using here the useState method, because this component has the list of the categories, the food categories, as an internal state. So we see that useState initializes the state as an empty array of type meal props element. This is only in TypeScript. We can specify the type of objects and variables. And we are assigning the result of this function to the two variables list and setList to render and change it. The first thing we see is that we have the useEffectMap method with an empty dependency list. So this function is called only when the component has been mounted, because we have the empty dependency list. If we put here a variable, for example, it will be recalled every time the variable changes. In this case, we are telling React to fetch from this API the list of the food categories, and then transform it in JSON, and then takes data that are the result of this then branch, and use them to set the list with the categories. This is just the structure of the object this endpoint returns. But we can see that this is an example of promise. A promise is just an asynchronous function that lets you write to two or more than two branches that are basically the then one, the then branch, and also the catch to tell React what to do in case of success or failure of this function, because this is asynchronous. Then we have the return statement, in which we are just creating a div that contains an unordered list, that is the list of categories. And here we are writing in curly brackets the JavaScript code. As we saw before, we can write JavaScript code inside the JSX code using curly brackets. So we are telling here, use the list array taken from the endpoint from the API, and for each one of them, create a new component, a component meal category, passing them the key property and the item itself and the function onLike. So we are propagating the function from onLike function from the root component that defines it to the first child, the product list, that it propagates it to the children. It won't use it. It just propagates it to the children. And then we have the other component, the meal category, that's just this part of application. So it contains the picture, the string, and the icon. In fact, we can see we have a container, but this is just a syntax for style component. That is something, a new package, another package that allows you to write CSS, CSS directly in TypeScript 5, in this case. And we can define a new component with style starting from an HTML-like tag. So we are creating container, but it's basically a list with some style. So we have the list with the ID, we have the list item with the ID of the category as the ID of the component. Then we have an image that is basically another one of styled component with some style, but is just an image HTML tag. Then a footer that is just a div containing some text, is the, in fact, contains the name of the category, and then a toggler that is the heart image. This takes the function. So we are propagating more the function to handle the click on the heart icon. So basically it will be handled here. We on click of this toggler, we are calling on like with the props. So when the user click on the heart, this will call the on click on like method passed by the parent with the props itself to identify the element that has been clicked.
Sorry, I missed in the app TSS.
Yes.
I missed the need to pass the favorites to the callback. What is why it is needed to pass in the use callback the list of favorites, the state?
Because we are using it inside. So this is, in this case, just to avoid React to give you some warnings and error, because when you use a variable inside your callback,
like pass,
it tells you that you're missing something in your use callback function, because it understands that you are using it inside of the use callback.
It's not related like the use effect.
In this case, it means that every time the favorites list changes, it will be instantiated. You can think that is that will be a loop. But in this case, I think it's not so, but we can see. I mean, I think we have not looped, no. But I will indicate more on this. So then we have the favorite spam panel, that is the second element of the application, that has another state, and is always an internal state of the components that describes if the panel is visible or not. This this function will be called every time the user click on this arrow. So this click call this function that changed the visible property. In fact, we have the property is visible that is used here of the panel component, and then it will it has two children components that are the favorites list and the button to toggle the set visible the visible property is visible. Let's see now the favorites component too, that is just a list of string. In this case, we have a title, an H1 tag, and then an unordered list that takes the favorites array and map them to create list items with a key to help React in the re-rendering process, as we saw before. And then we just have the child with the string category name. If we go back to the app.tsx file, I want you to let note again that we are managing the state in the root node. This is because we have to pass some parts of the same state to different components. So we have to generate it in the root one, that is the most the nearest one that is in common as a parent for the components that have to manage that part of the state. So, for example, now we can add a new action if you want. We can add the action that.
Question.
Yes.
So I see that the main pattern here is that you have functions that you pass down as props.
Yes.
two components. So if I take a component of the one that you described,
yes, for example,
product list. I have no idea where the online comes from.
Yes.
There are some, I mean, by reading the code, is there some styling guide or some recommendation from React to let this code be? I mean, this code is readable, but it's not understandable because I don't know if that's online. I mean, if it was Python, there would have been an import telling me
where
module where that online lives. Here, I don't know.
In this case, you just have you just define the properties of the component, but you have to go back to the parents to find who is the first one that defines that that function, for example. But this is in this case. Then we will see that there's a simpler way to define components and state updates without doing this. And with Redux, yes.
Okay. And that one. The other question is the use callback function that is not here, it's in the app.
In the app, TS6, maybe.
Yeah. Is this using user thread underneath? Because it seems to me the same, almost the same pattern of the use effect function that you
the use effect doesn't return anything, it returns void. Use effect is
so the use callback does not
the use effect it's used to specify where when to call a function. So we can just specify to if we want to call that function when the component has been mounted or when it's updated with the dependency list. But we cannot call the function as a normal function. Using use callback, we are just declaring a function. We are initializing a new function, and then we can call it in the code.
Okay. So my question is, use callback, which is provided by
React,
is using use effect underneath and wrapping it into a function?
No. It's just two different things.
Two different things, but they have almost the same signature because there are apps here and a function.
Yes, a lot of the React hooks have dependency are based on dependency list. So
but
I think that
meanings.
Yes, different meanings because this.
But we have to call the function manually. It's not that if I
the use
call set favorites from somewhere, this function gets called.
No, okay. You have to call it manually. Okay. This just tells React when it has to instantiate new memory for this function.
Okay.
So we can add a new function if you want. We can maybe want to add a function that when we click on the element in the favorite list, it will be removed. There's no time, so we're going to speak about Redux, and my presentation is here. So
homework
add other functions. So as we saw, when we have to define a function, and this function it's manages a part of the state that is used from many components, we have to define it in a root component and then pass it as a reference with a reference to the children components. But this has been solved with a new package that is Redux that help us to have a central state, a centralized and a global state that stays in just one place. We have to note that that Redux is not React. Redux is an independent package, and it could be used also standalone with the Node.js or something else. But the use with React is the most common use, because helps a lot building user interfaces with a centralized state. To use Redux package in a React project, you just have to install and import the React Redux package. And we now see the basic idea about Redux, because why it simplifies our applications. So we have, using Redux, we will have just a centralized state. So we have just one state object for all the components that will contain all the key of the state of all components. And this state will be used to define the user interface depending on the state of that moment that is used by users to trigger actions. For example, with clicks or compiling a form or something else. So the users trigger actions, and the actions are sent to the reducer. Reducer that is just a JavaScript function that is the only access point to the store, that is the container for the state. So we have a centralized state that is updated through the action of the users, but we just have one single access point to the store containing the state. And this access point is just a function, a JavaScript function. Let's see how Redux is helpful for React application. So we say that the Redux principles are that there is a single source of truth. So the central state that is contained into the store is the only source to define the application UI. This helps us to prevent from unexpected behaviors. For example, if we duplicate some state part into different components, or if we manage the same state from two different points and we overwrite some changes. So this makes our code clearer. The state is read-only because components cannot change the state of the application. They just trigger function by the user actions. So they trigger actions, in fact, that calls the reducer function, passing the action as an argument, and then the reducer makes the changes and the updates to the state. And note that the reducer are pure functions. So for each input, an action with an actual state will output also always the same result. Note that I wrote reducers at the plural form because we say that there must be always just one reducer in one application, but we have also packages that allow us to write many reducers and then combine them into one. But this is just to clean code, to have clean code, and to understand easily your code. Let's see some keywords from Redux. We said we have the state that is always a JSON object that represents the application state, so the global application state, in which it's contained the state of all the components, and Redux defines a way to manage it. But my question is, can a component still have an internal state, in your opinion?
Yes. It can have an internal state for local action and then trigger action on a central store.
Yes. For example, if you have to build a form with some inputs, you can develop your custom inputs that are based on HTML inputs, and you can maintain the text of the input itself in the internal state of the inputs, maybe, and then on the submit of the form, you can send them the values to the global store. This is just an example. Then we have the store, that is, as we said, the element that keeps track of the state. And the store is connected to a React application. Then it can be changed through action passing by the reducer. We will see it also in the code. That will be more clearer. And then we have the actions that are simply functions that make the dispatcher of action that are objects containing the action type and optional payloads. You can see this action, the action word is repeated, but you have to imagine the action as the click of the users that will let React and Redux dispatch an action that is just an object that describes the action itself, that is then handled by the reducer to update the state. Then we have the reducer, in fact, that is are pull functions that handle the application state, and they commonly contain a switch statement on the action type, and then they define specific behavior for each one of them. As we said, we can there must be one single reducer, but you can define many reducers and then use the combined reducer method from Redux that just let you write a clearer code. Then there's the connect, that is just a function that is used to connect, in fact, your components to the store. And it introduced two new functions that are very, very important. They are commonly called map state to props and map dispatch to props that you can use to define which part of the state and of which part of actions you defined your components having as interest to. So for example, if you want to build a component that want to read and to manage with the action just a subset of the global state, you define in these two methods which are the state properties and the actions it wants to receive, to use. And then we have selectors that are just helper functions that is to write clean code always, because we can write from, for example, we have the loading props that is just the state.loading key. We can just use a selector as export const is loading that is equal to a function that takes the state and returns the state loading property. This is just a helper function to define, for example, in just one file and to make it easier to find them. Okay, now we will see the same code of the application we saw before, but with Redux in the code. So you see that if I start my application in this branch with Redux, the application, the user interface will be the same interface as before, because we have the categories, we have the panel and the favorite list, we have the same behavior of before. But if we go to the code, we will see a lot of differences. Starting from the app component, in fact, we don't see any functions, any JavaScript code. We just have the app components that contains the product list component and the favorites final one. So let's start from the index.txt file. We have to see that in this file, we have to create the store. So with the function create store, we are creating the store, passing it our reducer as an argument. And if we go to see the reducer code that is in the store here, the reducer function is the only function that changes the state. And so is always the reducer that defines the initial state. In this case, we have also the types, because we are in TypeScript, and here we are creating the state with the initial state, and this function will be called from Redux, passing it the state and the action it receives. Then it will switch on the action type, and for each one of them we will update the state in a different way. For example, in this case, for the action set categories, that is the action that is called dispatched when the endpoint of the API with the food categories send a response, we are returning a new object with the old key of the old state, and we are putting in the product list key the old product, a new array obtained from the old product list array with the categories array passed in the action, because action can contain also values, payloads, and not only the type, obviously. Yes, so note that we are always returning a new object, and for each type of action, we always return a new state with different keys updated. So the reducer is the only function that can update the state. Then we have the action. The action file, in which I defined my application actions. In this case, they're not so much, so I have all in one file, it's just for example. And we have the set categories, toggle panel, and add favorite actions. We can see that they are just interfaces in which I define the type of each field. For example, we have the set categories and the build props array, and etc. And this is important to note, that an action must always have the type field, because the reducer will be able to switch on them and to understand which is the behavior to follow based on the action type. But we also can introduce new key, for example, categories in this case, or category here. So let's go back to the app component, in which we say that the structure is more is easier now, because we don't have JavaScript code, but just the J6 with the two components as before. And if we go to the product list component, we see that we don't have anymore the use state function, because we are passing the list of the product of the food, in this case, from the state, using the two functions that I said before. So map state to props and map dispatch to props. In this function, we are telling React which are the field of the state that this component wants to use. In fact, we are telling that from the state, this component will have to receive as props the product list that will be used to be rendered as the list of milk category as before. And then in the map dispatch to props method, we are telling and specifying which are the functions and the actions that this component can dispatch. In this case, the product list can dispatch the set category action when it receives the answer from the API, and the unlike action that add the item to the favorites list when a meal category, a meal object, is clicked. In this case, I still passing it as a props, but I could be it should be here in this component. But this is just an example. We have to connect this component to the store and then pass to it directly the unlike function from the store. It's more correct. But this to let understand how Redux works. Now, if there's time, we can add a new action just to see an example of how to create actions with React and Redux. So we have just to go to the action file, and I can add a new function in the same way I did for the first action. And we add the remove favorite action that has a type as the other ones, but we have to define first the type of the action. And then we say here that the type of this action is the remove favorite action. And we want also to pass a category here because we want to know which is the category to remove from the favorite list. So the category that is of type meal props, that is defined in the meal props file. Then we have to export it as an action, just as for the others. So remove favorite. And from this moment, we have also the remove favorite action that we can use in the favorites list component. As you can see, in this component, I didn't connect the component itself to the store. But if I need to dispatch an action from this component, I just can use the map state to props and map dispatch to props. I will copy them to do faster. And then I will go to the favorites and I will export, not this with this syntax, but connecting it to the store. So I will change this to map state to props. The only part of the state we are using is the favorites. And then we want to dispatch the new action that is the on remove favorite. We can call this. And this is just a function that returns the dispatch function from Redux of the action with the type remove favorite. Then we have to export and connect the.
In this case, you are using the remove favorite to redact to the Redux store and add favorite using props.
Yes, because it's just an error or transforming. Yes, because I transform this application from without Redux into with Redux, but this is just an error. So I will let you see how to create a new action correctly now.
So maybe you also to answer Giacomo's question, to comment on Giacomo's comment. In this way, maybe it's clearer where the function comes from. Or
probably you don't need to think about functions, but about states and state changes. So here I mean the syntax is still not so clear. That map state to props does not give enough information to me. But when you get used to, you can think of this as okay, in this file, whatever it does, I change the product list and I do it with these two functions or actions. Yeah. And then you will trust that it works underneath. But I mean, it's clearer than having to go back 100 files to search for a props that you know that someone will also change the name between the original prop and the props that you are seeing in the last file. So it's nice. This is a little bit clearer. Still, I think that there is too much boilerplate from, why I have, it's not clear because I have, I see a record of something that is an object, a dictionary with a key, and then a function that returns
the dispatch function that we
that I don't know what it does. I mean, what is the type of this function? So, it's not clear from looking at it. But I understand that after you do a couple of tutorials or
it will be fast and increase.
I mean, remember that we are used to when to the embedded where there should have been written something like this function returns in there of 32 bits with alignments of 4 bytes of the memory. So that's
this way. So maybe it's better to backup the user action to the effect that these actions triggers.
Yeah, also it decouples a lot from the underlying medium. I mean, here you are not, I don't see HTML a lot as we were seeing in the examples before, other than the fact that you are using the symbols and the brackets, but I mean, there is no div, there is no strange stuff.
There is an abstraction layer.
Yeah, there's an abstraction layer that's.
Yeah, because we are passing favorites here, and we have to pass favorites here and remove favorite. Okay, I don't know. Because it takes an argument, it is G of type new props. Yes.
You see? You don't know what.
But this is. Okay.
Also, the magician is. All the magic is in the connect. Function.
Yes, that is a function because that takes two functions returning a function
that maps to the favorites the props. The props of the
exactly,
favorite
exactly,
function.
Yes. It takes these two functions. You can also put null as an argument if you don't want to dispatch action from this component, but you have to pass these two functions that indicate specify which part of the state and actions, and then it will connect the component directly with the state and the action defined in the store.
Yeah, and also,
No, I was wondering if this connect map state to props, dispatch props, under the hood uses the props.
It will take from the state. And then it passes because it's connected to the store that contains the state.
Because the reducer updates the state, and then the state through this connect function updates the
but
directly.
But can
the
only
process.
Be read, not right.
However, apart from the comments on the clarity of the code,
just
I
to
think
finish it.
That's the
I will add the code.
Real advantage of this stuff. Is that you can write this class, the UI element in isolation with rest that
and reuse them.
Oh. Yeah. I always make the example of ZStudio that is made with JavaScript alone. And everything is interconnected. If you change something in the state is in the DOM itself, or partly in the DOM, partly outside. And so you cannot ask Kari to write a new button for something else, because if you write a new button, you may break stuff in other places. And it has always been like this, not only for ZStudio, but for web development, regardless of the framework you were using, until a couple of advancements. The first advancement is this decoupling, and the second is the using of the usage of TypeScript, okay, because it's JavaScript with types that allows you to avoid or to prevent 90% of the errors that we have found out in the bug before React and before TypeScript. Because if you, in normal JavaScript without types, you just pass an object to something and
without knowing anything about.
So you spend your time wondering why everything breaks, and you find that you pass something without field. This does not happen in that. Or you get that screen that tells you something is wrong, which is better than the button does not work and I have to go into the console looking for strange stuff.
So we are getting it from the state now. Adding this code, it's no. We have, okay, but yeah. Okay, so that's the way to add the function, the two actions, but I should have to look the code more attention. But you understand that this is the structure of creating an application with Redux gives you a little more easiness to understand where each thing is in the code. And that's all. If you have any other questions?
Yes. I think that actually the model under Redux is that you can have as many stores as you want.
The store is okay.
You can pass more. I did it once. So you can pass more storage to the one component.
And then combine them.
And then use them as separate files, probably.
Yes, the only important thing is that all of them are independent one from the other.
Is that
do you mean many stores?
You can create in the app whatever it is.
In the index.
There you create a store and you pass it to the provider. You can create 3-4 stores and pass them down to different providers. It's a feature. I still don't have a use case for this stuff. I was asking Enrico for a use case.
I'm not sure about this because I never used it. But
the alternative is to use the different keys in the same
system.
Yes.
Maybe also for
I don't know, probably it's importing stuff from third parties that use their store. Different stuff.
I also had a question about the reducer. Yeah. You say that you can have multiple reducers.
Yes.
What is the use case to use multiple reducers only for
just to split and give a structure to your code? For example, if you have a page of your application that's a container that contains a lot of components and each of them triggers many actions, you could want to build a reducer just for this container with all the actions of the children components. But if you have another container with the same behavior before, with components, children components and actions, you can create a new reducer that handles only that part of the application.
You must be sure that the reducer does not listen to the same action.
Yes, of course, and you must be sure that there is just one reducer of them that updates a key of the state. Mm-hmm. You cannot have two reducers that updates the same key.
It's not the React framework that tells you, warning you are using.
I think that there's some warning when you try to update the same key. Yes.
In this example, for instance, the add and remove favorites are totally related to the token panel actions.
You can create a reducer only for this.
For the panel actions, yes.
So now we just have four actions.
But it increases the number of actions.
It's increasing the complexity of the deployment.
Okay.